him.
Child, you know how anxious your guardian is that you should improve yourself in every way. She lays particular stress on your ecclesiastical lessons as she was leaving from town yesterday. Indeed, Hermione often turns to your godliness as she is leaving for town.
Dear Jacqueline is so very serious. Sometimes she is so serious, I think she cannot be quite well.
Your guardian enjoys the best of health, and the gravity of her demeanor is especially to be commended in one so young. I know no one with a higher sense of duty and responsibility.
I suppose that is why she looks so bored when we three are together.
Cecil! I am surprised at you. Miss Worthing has many troubles in her life. Idle merriment and triviality would be out of place in her conversation. You must remember her constant anxieties about that unfortunate young woman, her sister.
I wish she would let that unfortunate young woman, her sister, to come down here every once in a while. We might have a good influence on her, Miss Prism. I'm sure you know German and geology and things of that kind that could influence a woman very much. Oh,
I do not think even I can produce any effect on a character who, according to her own sister's admissions, is irretrievably weak and vacillating. Indeed, I'm not so sure I could choose to redeem her. Oh, I'm not of the modern mania of turning bad people into good people at a moment's notice. As a man sows, so shall he reap. Cecil? Cecil, you must put that journal away. I really don't see why you should keep one at all.
I keep a journal in order to enter the wonderful secrets of my life, otherwise I should forget all about them.
Memory, my dear Cecil, is the journal we all keep about.
Yes, but it usually chronicles the things that have never happened before and couldn't possibly have happened. I believe that memory is responsible for all the 3-volume novels that Muddy sends us.
Do not speak slightingly of a 3-volume novel, Cecil. I wrote one myself in earlier days.
Did you really, Miss Prism? How wonderfully clever you are. Did it end happily? I do not like novels that end happily. They depress me so much.
Good and happily, and the bad unhappily. That is what fiction means.
I suppose so, but it seems rather unfair. And was your novel ever published?
Oh, alas, no. The manuscript was unfortunately abandoned. I use that word in the sense of lost or mislaid. To your work, child, speculation is profitless.
Oh, but I see dear Dr. Chasuble coming up to the garden.
Oh,
Dr. Chasuble! This isn't your pleasure.
And how are we this morning? I presume you are, I trust, well.
Miss Prism has just been complaining of a slight headache. I think it would do her much good to go on a short stroll through the park with you, Dr. Chasuble.
Cecil, I have not mentioned anything of a headache.
I know, Miss Prism, but I felt it instinctively, and in fact, I was thinking of that, and not my ecclesiastical lesson when the dear Reverend came in.
I hope, Cecil, you were not inattentive.
Oh, I am afraid I am.
That is strange. Were I fortunate enough to be Miss Prism's pupil, I would hang upon her lips. I spoke metaphorically. My metaphor was drawn from
bees.
Miss Worthing, I suppose, has not returned from the town yet.
We do not look for her till Monday afternoon.
Ah, yes. She usually likes to spend her Sundays in London. Indeed, she's not one of those whose sole aim is enjoyment, as by all accounts that unfortunate young woman her sister seems to be. But I must not disturb Egeria and her pupil any longer.
Egeria? My name is Letitia, Dr. Chasuble.
A classical illusion, merely, drawn from the pagan authors. I shall see you both, no doubt, in heaven some.
I think, dear doctor, that I will have a stroll with you. I find I do have a headache after all, and your work might do it good.
With pleasure, Miss Prism, with pleasure. We might go as far as the screws and back.
Oh, that sounds delightful. Cecil, in my absence, you will read your Bible, Jeremiah 99, to begin with.
Thank you. and daughters that they shall eat one another's flesh so as to press the siege against their enemies to destroy them. How horrid. Worthing was in town.
Yes, sir. She seemed very much disappointed. I mentioned that you and Miss Prism were regarded. She said she was anxious to speak with you privately for a moment.
Tell Miss Chastity Worthing to come in and speak to the housekeeper about a room for her.
Yes, sir.
I have never met any real wicked person before. I am rather frightened. I'm afraid she will look just like everyone else. She does.
Temptation.
detrimental, not even to her.
That depends on the intellectual sympathies of the woman. Maturity can be depended upon. Rightness can be trusted. Young women are green.
Toothache, and I have some. arrive this afternoon. Curious and heartless is to disown your sister, no matter how badly she may have behaved to you in the past, she is still your sister. I will go to the dining room and fetch her. And you will be kind to her, won't you, Jacqueline?
These are very joyful tidings!
As we have all been resigned to her loss, her return seems to me peculiarly distressing.
My sister in the dining room? I don't know what that means. I think it absurd.
Chastity has just been telling me about her poor friend, Miss Bunbury, who she goes to visit so very often. Also, there must be some good in someone who is kind to an invalid and leaves the pleasures of London to visit a bed of pain.
She's been talking about Bunbury, has she?
Yes, she has told me all about Mrs. Bunbury and her terrible state of health.
Well, she is not to talk to you about Bunbury or anything else for that matter. It's enough to drive one perfectly frantic.
Of course, I admit, the thoughts were all on my side. However, I feel Sister Jacqueline's coldness to me is peculiarly painful. I had expected a more enthusiastic welcome, especially considering it is the first time I have come here.
Jacqueline, if you do not take your sister's hand, I shall never forgive you.
Never forgive me.
Never, never, never!
Luggage, madam. I unpacked it and put it in the room next to your own.
Her luggage?
Yes, madam. Three portmanteaus addressed.
for a nice drive?
No, she's going to... Send me away!
And have you got a spot?
Yes, I'm afraid so! It's a very painful parting.
It is always very painful to part from someone whom one has known for a very brief space of time. The absence of old friends one can endure with equanimity, but even a momentary separation from someone whom one has just been introduced to is almost unbearable. Like what name?
Oh, any name you like. Arabella.
never written a single book, so you can imagine how much he knows.
We must see him at one of the most important christening. I mean, our most important business.
Oh?
I shan't be more than a half an hour.
Oh, Chastity. Considering that we've been engaged since the 14th of February last, and that I only actually met you today, half an hour seems a bit long. Could you not make it 20 minutes?
I'll be back in no time.
What an impetuous girl she is. I like her hair so much, I must write a sonnet dedicated to its texture.
Mr. Fairfax has just called to see Miss Worthing on very important business, Mr. Fairfax states.
Isn't Jacqueline in her library?
She went off in the direction of the rectory some time ago.
Tell the young man to come in. I'm sure Jacqueline is bound to be back soon. And bring out the rackets. Perhaps we might play a game of badminton. I suppose one of the elder gentlemen associated with Jacqueline and her philanthropic work. I do not quite like men who are involved in philanthropic work. I think it is so forward of them.
Mr. Fairfax.
Pray, let me introduce myself. My name is Cecil Cardew.
Cecil Cardew. Oh, what a very strong name. Something tells me that we are going to be great friends.
How kind you've liked me after such a comparatively short amount of time. Pray sit down.
I may call you Cecil, may I not?
If you wish.
And you will always call me Geoffrey, won't you?
With pleasure.
Then that is all quite settled, is it not?
I hope so.
Perhaps this might be a favorable opportunity for me to mention who I am. My father is Lord Bracken. You have never heard of him, I suppose.
I don't think so.
Outside the family circle, my father, I am glad to say, is entirely unknown. This is how it should be. The home seems to me to be the proper sphere for a man. And once he begins to neglect his household duties, he becomes painfully effeminate, does he not? And I don't like that. My mother, whose views on education are remarkably strict, has brought me up to be rather short-sighted. It is part of her system. So you might be looking at you through a glass.
Oh, of course not, Geoffrey. I'm quite fond of being looked at.
You are here on a short visit, I suppose.
Oh, no, I live here.
Really? Your mother, no doubt, or some other advanced female relative of high years resides here also.
Oh, no, I have no mother, nor in fact relations.
Indeed.
Yes, Miss Prism and Miss Worthing have the arduous task of looking after me.
I beg your pardon, Mr. Carby. Did you say Miss Worthing?
Yes, I'm Miss Worthing's ward.
Oh. It is strange that she never mentioned to me that she had a ward. How secretive of her. Oh, she grows more interesting by the hour. I am not sure that the news inspires me with feelings of unmixed delight. I am very fond of you, Cecil. I have liked you ever since I met you. But I am bound to state that now that I know you are Miss Worthing's ward, I can't help expressing a wish that you were, well, just a little older than you seem to be, and not quite so very alluring in appearance. In fact, if I may speak candidly...
Oh, pray do I say that whenever anyone has anything unpleasant to say, one must speak quite candidly.
Well, to speak with perfect candor, Cecil, I wish that you were fully 42 and more than usually plain for your age. Chastity has a sweet and trusting nature. She is the very soul of truth and honor. Disloyalty would be as impossible to her as deception. But even women of the noblest possible moral character are extremely susceptible to the physical charms of others. Modern, no less than ancient history, supplies us with many most awful examples of what I refer to. If it were not so, indeed, history would be quite unreadable.
I beg your pardon, Geoffrey. Did you say Chastity? Oh, but it is not Miss Chastity Worthing, who is my guardian. It is her sister, her elder sister.
Chastity never mentioned to me that she had a sister.
Oh, no, I'm afraid to say that they have not been on very good terms for a long time.
Ah, that accounts for it. And come to think of it, I have never heard of any woman mentioning her sister. The subject seems distasteful to most women. Cecil, you have lifted a load off of my mind. I was growing almost anxious. It would have been horrid if a cloud had come across a friendship as grand as ours, would it not? Mm-hmm. Of course, you are quite sure that it is not Miss Chastity Worthing who is your guardian.
Quite sure. In fact, I'm going to be hers.
I beg your pardon.
Oh, Geoffrey, my dear friend, there's no reason why I should make a secret out to you. The local county newspaper assured me. The fact chronicled soon enough, but Miss Chastity Worthing and I are engaged to be married.
My dear friend Cecil, there must be some error. Miss Chastity Worthing is engaged to me. The announcement will appear in the Morning Post on Saturday, the latest.
You must be under some strange mistake. I posted Chastity exactly 10 minutes ago.
For I asked Chastity to be my wife yesterday afternoon at 5:30. If you would care to verify the incident for yourself. I never travel without my journal. One should always have something sensational to read in the train. I am very sorry, dear Cecil, if it is of any disappointment to you, but I'm afraid I have the prior claim.
Geoffrey, you would cause me more anguish than I can tell you to cause you any physical or psychological distress, but I am bound to point out that since you have been bound to Chastity, she has clearly changed her mind.
If the poor lady has become entrapped by any foolish promise, I shall consider it my duty to rescue her at once, and with a firm hand.
Whatever entanglement my sweet girl has gotten herself into, I shall never reproach her from it when we are married.
To me, Mr. Cardew, as an entanglement? Oh, you are presumptuous. On an occasion of this kind, it becomes more than a moral duty to speak one's mind. It becomes a pleasure.
Do you suggest, Mr. Fairfax, that I have entrapped Chastity? How dare you! This is no time for the shallow masks of manners. When I see a spade, I call it a spade.
I am glad to say that I have never seen a spade. It's obvious that our social spheres have been widely different.
Would you like to play, sir?
Certainly. And Mr. Fairfax will be my partner.
Your part, my dear Cecil. Easy to make for one so young.
As is taking one's eye.
felt that you were false and deceitful. I am never deceived in such matters. My first opinions of people are invariably right.
It seems to me, Mr. Fairfax, that I am trespassing on your valuable time. Certainly you have other calls of similar character to make amongst the neighborhood.
A chastity! My own chastity!
Jeffrey, darling.
A moment. May I ask if you are engaged to be married to this young man?
This ghastly state of things is what you call Bunbury, I suppose.